really came from realization. You know, it was realizing who your friends are and who aren't, you know, and really just thinking about where I came from, where I come from, what I'm built on, the way I was built and put together by whatever was around me from day one. And add that to realizing who your friends are and who aren't. And in this game, you know, I put a lot of time in this game. You know, some look at me as a youngin' or a rookie, and some also look at me as a veteran. So it's kind of like a weird mixture of the two. But, you know, I put a lot of time in this game and met a lot of people, come across a lot of friends and people I thought were friends, and made friends in the game and made people who I thought was friends. And it really just came from that. The music is for them. You know, at the end of the day, I just wanted to speak about us and make something that they could continue to be proud of. Because one thing I've been blessed to do all this time is make music that my friends are proud of. Make music that my friends look at and say, yeah, that's us. Or yeah, that's exactly how it was. It's never fabricated. It's never added on. It's never made to sway one way or another. It's never that. You know, it's always what it was and what it is. So the goal was just to continue to do that. This album is just my two cents. It's my two cents on how I grew up with my friends, how we came together. If you look at the cover, those are my real friends on the cover. You know, when I was talking to my man, Chris Murray, who did the cover, I literally said, draw a kid, dark skin, bald head, glasses. I literally pointed all my friends out. So when I text them the cover, they was like, oh shit, son, that's me. And they knew who, yo, that's me at the bottom of the step. Yo, that's me with my back turned. It's always about who it's never changed from. It's always been about your friends, and it's still about your friends. It's always about the motherfuckers who cheered you on no matter what, and it's still about them. If you're a true diehard fan and you get it and you've been rocking from day one, or you started rocking yesterday, but you got the whole catalog and you comprehended it and you study and you listen and you know it and you appreciate it, then you're a friend because you get it. You know, if you relate to everything I'm kicking, and you're a friend. Just, to me, it's an extremely important album. It's an extremely important album for the genre, for the culture, and just for the times. So whether I'm on this or Dream Deferred or whatever it may be, nothing changes. It's always just constant elevation, but nothing changes as far as the music, nothing changes as far as the content, nothing changes as far as the story and the message and why it's so important to me and why I hope it's important to you as well. Nothing ever changes with that. There's never a, dad, is he gonna be able to go back to what it was? Is he gonna be able to bring it like he used to? Why wouldn't I? I'm still shooting 1,000 jumpers in the gym every day, and I'm still aware of everything going out here while I'm shooting jumpers. So you add the two together, nothing's gonna change. It's only just gonna heighten. It's just gonna continue to heighten, and that's it.
I'd like to know, are you really ready for some super dynamite soul?
Caring about what anybody outside of my friends thinks about the project. So of course, like, I care about people liking it, wanting it, you know, falling in love with it, relating to it, as always. But the idea is really, like, the stories are more so about myself and the people I grew up with, more than anything else. Right, you know what I mean? All they know is me and buying a record on iTunes or listening to something on the radio or downloading something on that Piff or Audio Mac or something like that. You know what I mean? Like, they know nothing else about the industry, and they don't care to.
because they have so much other stuff going on. They're really living these lives that so many other people talk about or portray or whatever it is. They're really living
their lives.
Right, yeah. So they could care less about the industry. I grew up a certain way. I came up a certain way, so I brought those morals and values and all that into the industry. Just like I bring those morals and values into anything else that I do. It's not like I hit a light switch like, oh, you're supposed to be 100% straight up and stand up when you here, but when you over here, you're supposed to switch sides and be funny so that you can survive, or you're supposed to go this way so that you...
Regardless of which state
you're like, however I'm raised is how I'm raised. So I'm carry the same traits and everything with me, no matter where I'm at or what I'm doing or who I'm with. And it's sad to say a lot of these motherfuckers is different. And I realized that right before I started making this out. Right. So it's probably the most personal project I've ever done. And the deeper you go into it as far as what you listen to, the more it all unravels and the thread comes out and you see it all together, you know what I mean? So it makes sense when it's all together.
It's the DNA of your makeup.
Yeah, absolutely, 100%. 100%.
No, but that's real though, because like, and I find it interesting that that came to you recently.
Right.
You know, juxtaposed.
Like last year.
You know, last year, for someone who's been doing music a long time.
Right.
And then for that revelation to hit you, like, hold up, let me look at my surroundings.
Yeah.
And he's like,
yeah,
it really ain't what I thought it was. Mm-hmm. You know, I got a similar upbringing. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
As far as having morale, ethics.
Right.
I don't switch. You know what I'm saying? Whether I'm in the hood, whether I'm in a corporate setting, I'm the same. The essence of who I am is the same. I'm not gonna leave certain things out just to be fitting to a certain social institution. I am who I am.
Yeah,
so,
it's like you. The way we came up is like, you mean what you say what you mean. And that's it. If I stand on that, your word. Exactly. If I stand on that, I stand on that. If I stand on this, I stand on this. And that's all it is. And it's so little of that in this shit. You know what I mean? But whether I was doing this, or if I was, you know, working for ESPN, or if I was outside on the corner, or if I was in med school somewhere, whatever it could have been, I would still be the same Skyler. Like, I would still be the same person. You know what I mean? But this game, it's like when your name is so-and-so, you do this, and then when you go home and you the name on your license, then you that, and it's different, and I'm not me, and I can't sleep like that, you know what I mean? I can't look in the mirror if I was to be that guy, you know, so this is for everybody who ain't that guy, you know what I mean?
Right, like, it's almost like
who stays who they are, you know what I'm saying?
This is the crib. 133 St. James, the old crib. I know I've talked about it in docs in the past, but being in my music represents me and how I grew up and how I came up, and it's a reflection of everything that built me and made me who I am. I gotta always take it back to where I'm from, where I've been, what made me who I am. So this is the crib, 133 St. James, between Gates and Green. Every day for however many years before my pops busted moved to Queens, this was the crib. Talk about it in all my music, how Big lived down the block. Big was right there, past the lights, between Gates and Fulton. So that was that way. Big was 226 St. James. I was 133 St. James, so it literally was right here. Big used to be parked out here with the Lex down the block, with the Lex and the Benz and whatever, whatever. It was all, you know, it was what it was. Everything I talk about was happening on these brownstone blocks and further down, and lobbies on the other parts, and you know, it was all up and down here. It changed a lot, man. It's night and day. You know, that gentrification thing is real. Everything Spike be saying, everything my big brother be saying, it's real, man. Like, gentrification is real life. You don't want to hear my views on it. That's a different story. This is where I grew up, though. The building used to be baby blue. It was gray, but it was a gray that was so unique, it looked baby blue. So anybody who knew me knew, oh, Scott lived in the baby blue building, he lived in the blue building. So, you know, oh, me that Scott crib, which one? Oh, the blue building. So that was that. They flipped it and made it brick and all that, but. Black Lives Matter. Indeed.
Oh, scared to death. By this race I've run, all that's left is everything I want. Slowly losing my time, quickly taking.
Seems my friends are few. Mama said
it's
happiness comes from money. Happiness comes from money. Mama said, oh, oh, oh.
Yeah, that one was super dope. That one was super dope. Alright, so it's just one more left. This is the last one, and you could just put your stamp.
Ooh, you got some Henny?
Scared to death by this race I run. All that's left is everything I want. Slowly losing my time, quickly taken back from me. Seems my friends are few. Mama said prepare to pay, 'cause happiness comes from money.
Money makes us happy. Money makes us happy. Money makes us happy. They say
happiness
money makes us happy.
Comes from money.
Money makes us happy. Money makes us happy. Money makes us happy. They say money makes us happy. Hey, money makes us happy.
This is PS 11 Park. This is where a whole lot of basketball went down. A whole lot of scrapping went down. 13, 14, 12, 13, whatever. A whole lot of I got necks and jumping some money for their necks and all that right over here. It's only two courts, but two courts felt like the world. It's light out here today. That's because it's still kind of cool out. But yeah, this is PS 11 Park. PS 11 Elementary School. I ain't go to PS 11. I always went to school in the city. Went to 261 for elementary school, and then I went to Clinton for junior high, and I went to ICE for high school. I went to Clinton School for Writers and Artists because I always wrote. Anytime I had time to dribble a ball, I was out here with it. And this playground is actually the first place I heard Illmatic, which to me is the greatest hip hop album of all time. You know, hands down. This playground is where I heard Illmatic for the first time. We was out here, it was April 94 when the joint first came out. We was out here playing ball, and you know, you had the older dudes, you had the hustlers and everybody out here posted, you had the whips posted outside and all that. And the whole Illmatic was on. You know, Illmatic is short, it's only 9 records, you know, it's an intro and then 9 songs. The whole Illmatic was played while we was playing ball a good 40 minutes, so I heard the whole Illmatic out here. And I knew who Nas was, obviously, from being a kid, being a fan, and, you know, the videos on Video Music Box, and, you know, Halftime, and It Ain't Hard to Tell, and all that, and, you know, The World Is Yours. But when the album first came out, like that weekend in April, this park is where I heard Illmatic for the first time, 100%.
So this is Southside, Jamaica, Queens. It's another big part of my upbringing. Growing up in Brooklyn, came up there until teenage years, right going into high school. And then once I got to high school, my pops moved to Queens. So I was going back and forth between Queens and Brooklyn. My mother was still in Brooklyn, my pops was in Queens. So I was going back and forth, doing the Trey Styles thing, like Boys in the Hood, you know, going back and forth, spending weekends over there, bringing a Nike duffel bag on the weekends to my mother's house or my pop's crib or whatever. So Southside is where a lot of what I talk about and a lot of what I've been through and all that, it comes from here as well. It comes from Brooklyn, like people know me as a Brooklyn head. And even out here, even when I lived out here, people knew old Skyzoo from Brooklyn, but I always had so much love for Southside Queens. They took me in as one of their own. And actually my best friend in the world, the tie to my J, if you will, is from right out here. And my homegirl, Jessie Wilson, actually lived further down. You know her from the Knowing, you know her from all the stuff with John Legend that she does. She just got a deal, congrats to my sister Jessie. She lived there, so we was here, and Jess lived a couple doors down. We would hear her singing in the crib. It was ridiculous. And this area is also kind of known as like Black Hollywood, so it's St. Albans, Southside, Jamaica, but it's, if you get really down to it, it's Asley Park, and it's known as like Black Hollywood, because back in the 50s and 60s and all that, a lot of famous jazz musicians and R&B soul singers, James Brown was out here, and Aretha Franklin and Eddie James and all them, like they all lived back here. So this was, you know, this is Black Hollywood. It's a lot of history, a lot of nostalgia with it. And of course, Lost Boys, and of course The Unit, and you know, all that, this is all out here as well.
If you're a baseball fan, what's goody, bro?
This the alley. We used to run through. You know what I mean?
Yup.
All types of summers, winters, falls.
You haven't been out here in a minute. Mm-hmm. I got scars down here. Man.
When it rained, I'd be full of water.
Mm-hmm.
We had to walk. We had to walk around.
The water would turn into a little sea.
Yep.
We had the back door. I used to bring joints in and out of the back door of the crib. You know what I mean? So I used to be able, you know, just being able to do whatever I want.
Yo, it's definitely something we need to get on tape though, but this is where I stayed.
Yeah, this
is
a crib.
I was standing right there, Sky coming through here with a basketball, and I'm just like, yo, bro, we want to come up? And it was all history from there.
Yep.
This is when Cortez's, Sky had on the Cortez's with the gold check.
Yo, so why your memory so vivid?
I'm sick with it.
I had the white Cortez's with the gold check. You know what I'm saying? That was 97.
Right.
Yeah, that was summer. That was summer 97.
Y'all all know that phrase, Sky's the rocks, man. Right? Now, look at that.
Look at that. Look at the graffiti, the spray paint.
Look at that when we was out here stenciling up. I think I made that stencil.
You probably did.
Like, yo, you heard that new Jada Kiss?
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, yeah, I heard it. He's like, I know the whole verse already. I'm like,
mm-hmm.
How you know the whole verse?
Believe it.
He's like, Kiss is the best.
Believe it. See? Toe heads. Thought I was bullshit when I used to say
it. I was right there.
Mm-hmm.
That's his crib. He used to scream like, come out.
Told you.
Check out.
I told you. Yup. Used to be, my joint was there. So I was in the window, and A was in his window, and we'd be yelling back and forth, yo, all right, cool, da-da-da-da-da. My pops would be like, yo, why y'all yelling across the yard? Just go to his house. I'd be like, I just came from his house. I don't want to go back over here. Then why'd you leave? You still talking about shit, you know? So literally, like, if I stood in the bathroom, the little window right there, A was up there in his room or bathroom or whatever, we could literally hang out the window and just have a conversation.
That's why they call me Alley Cat. Makes sense now? Makes sense?
Right.
Is that the phone watch? Why do you have that?
Because I'm lazy.
There's no way I'm doing that.
Yeah, because you got a gold watch.
Nah, but I'm not doing that, dog.
You see, when you're driving, your phone go off. I'm selling this for them now. When you're driving, your phone go off, you just, oh, I don't want to talk to that person.
Bing.
Oh, all right. Well, you answer. But when you need something, it's the best way.
Nah, he got it right now.
Yeah, I ain't knocking him. All right, let me ask you a real question. Kyrie or Curry?
Steph Curry. It's not a landslide, but Steph Curry.
Chinese restaurant, BM, pesos. So we was doing it, we was like 15, 16, ordering chicken wings, but the flip was lobster fried rice. Because if it was lobster, then it had to be, you know what I'm saying? Like, are we getting money? We buying lobster fried rice, go to the store, getting wine coolers, thinking we doing something, or get a bottle of Alizé up the block, whatever.
We in the
joint. Yeah, we in the joint, 16 years old, getting chicken wings with lobster fried rice, Alizé, you know? Being paid in full shit, you know what I'm saying? Like, we was like, yeah, we was 16 doing it, coming home buzz, like, you know, like, hey, the lobster fried rice was clutch though. We was like, yo, if you're getting lobster fried rice, it's more than just shrimp fried rice, vegetable fried, you're getting lobster and shit, I mean, you're doing it. I mean, you're doing something, I mean, you're getting money, you know, just being young and dumb. So with all that being said, when you're listening to the album, I just hope that you really take it for what it's worth. It's these dreams, these ideas, these nightmares, it's these moments of grandeur, it's these moments of despair, and everything in between that builds you and your friends up to who you are. And it literally is music for my friends. It's not for anybody else. It's not for the industry. It's not for anybody. If the industry fucks with it, dope. You know? It's not for, you know, the certain producers and rappers who, you know, I felt was friends but weren't and flaked out and did cornball shit. It's literally for my friends. But shout out to all of them for being the inspiration behind it. I just had some ideas of where I wanted to go. And then some things happened and I realized what was what. And I was like, yo, these motherfuckers ain't my friends. And the whole thing took on a life of its own. And it became music for my friends. The title changed and everything. It became music for my friends. So shout to all of them for being cornballs and suckers and all that. But more importantly, most importantly, it's really about all of y'all watching, being friends, being fans, being supporters. This album is literally music for my friends. Thank you.